written for a specific reason, for a specific goal. When Matthew begins to write, Matthew sets out to present Jesus Christ as a king. He sets out to present Jesus Christ as a king. When you read the book of Matthew, Jesus Christ is presented as a sevenfold king. He is the king of Israel. He is the king of the Jews. He is the national king. It talks about the kingship of Jesus Christ. It talks about the royalty of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Now, when Matthew begins to write, when Luke, on the other hand, begins to write, Luke sets out to make Jesus Christ. He paints a completely different picture of Jesus Christ. And the picture that Luke paints of Jesus Christ is a very important picture. Because when Luke begins to write, the summation of the Gospel of St. Luke is summed up in what he says in the Gospel of St. Luke, chapter number 19 and verse number 10, where he's talking about the mission statement of Jesus Christ. In the Gospel of St. Luke, chapter 19, verse 10, Jesus declares, "I came to seek and save that which was lost." And so the recurrent word in the Gospel of St. Luke is save and lost. But unlike Luke, when Mark begins to write, Mark is different. He also paints a completely different picture. Unlike Matthew, who presents Jesus Christ as the national king, unlike Luke, who talks to us that even though Jesus Christ was a king, he emptied himself of all what he had, came down to go between the nooks and creeks of society to find broken people like you and I. When Mark begins to write, he paints a completely different picture of Jesus. He says, even though he was a king, who did not stay in his royalty, who did not stay in his riches, who did not stay in his glory, he came down to save us, but he did not just come down to save us in weakness. So when Mark begins to write, what Mark sets out to do is to demonstrate the power of God. And the recurrent word in Matthew is the word power. And that is why the book of Mark, even though it is the shortest book among the synoptic gospels, it has twice as many miracles as Matthew, as Luke, and as John. Because Mark has a unique mandate. He wants to talk to us about the power of Jesus Christ. But when John begins to write, like we just read, John has a completely different mission. John wants to talk to us about who Jesus truly is. When John begins to write, if you read through his Gospels, especially chapter 21, John happens to conclude his Gospel twice. Because when Jesus Christ rose from the dead and encountered his disciples beside the Sea of Tiberias, after Peter's conversion, the Bible says, John declares, that these things were written so that you might believe. And that believing, you might know that Jesus Christ is the Son of the living God. So when John is writing, he sets to make Jesus Christ known. Because if you do not know him, you cannot be able to understand who he is. And if you do not understand who he is, you cannot know what he can do for you. And if you don't know what he can do for you, you cannot go to him. And if you do not go to him, you cannot be saved from your troubles. So in chapter 1, John begins to write. He presents Jesus Christ as the creator of all things. In John 1, he says, "In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God. And the Word was God." He says, "All things were made by him. And without him was nothing made that was made. In him was life. And the life was the light of men." In John chapter 2, he presents Jesus Christ after having presented him as the creator. In John chapter 2, he presents Jesus Christ as a miracle worker. He paints a picture of Jesus Christ having been invited to a wedding. And when he gets to that wedding, there is a need, a huge need. The most important element of the wedding is lacking, is missing, is finished. And when they turn to Jesus, not knowing what to do, they are confused. And his mother, having known who his son is, looks at the servants and says to them, whatever he tells you to do, do it. John is careful to let us know that this beginning of miracles Jesus performed, and his servants, his followers, believed in him. In John chapter 2, he is presented as a miracle worker. Do you know him as the man that can make the wine of your life to come back to where it ought to be? In John chapter 3, John also presents him as the source of salvation. There is a man whose name is Nicodemus. He comes to Jesus by night, and he's asking Jesus a question: what must I do to be saved? In John chapter 3, John is presenting Jesus Christ as the apex, as the embodiment of salvation. Salvation is not in the name of Hare Krishna. Salvation is not in the name of Muhammad. Salvation is not in the name of Buddha. Salvation is not in the name of the gods that some of you are worshiping. Salvation is in one name and one name only, and that name is the name of Jesus Christ. So in John chapter 3, he's careful to make us understand that if you and I must be saved, no matter what we are going through, we need just one person, and that person is the person of Jesus Christ. And John is careful to make us understand that this man was an intellectual. He was a rabbi. He was a Pharisee. He was a man who was schooled. But John, in presenting this whole thing about Nicodemus, he's trying to make you and I understand, my brothers and my sisters, that your education cannot save you. You may be an intellectual, you still need Jesus. Your money cannot save you. You may have money, but if you don't have Jesus, it's a waste of time. You may be beautiful, but your beauty will not take you to heaven. One thing and one person, and him alone, will take you to heaven, because he is the way, he is the truth, and he is the life. His name is Jesus. And having presented him as the source of salvation, in John chapter 4, he brings in something amazing, something really wonderfully amazing, because he introduces us to a woman who is a woman of Samaria, and that woman is a prostitute. That woman, everybody has given up on that woman. The woman had a PhD in husband snatching. She was an expert in husband snatching. In fact, those who wanted to learn about stealing people's husbands had to go to the woman. She was an expert. She had expertise in stealing husbands. If she passes beside your husband without your husband knowing, your husband will follow him. She was so bad that the other women in the city would not work with her. That's exactly why she was alone when she went to carry water. Because in Jewish custom, women do not go alone. Women go as a team because they are the weaker vessel. So if there is a problem, they can defend each other. But this woman was so bad that no woman wanted to walk with her. When it was her time to go for water, she went alone. Nobody cared about her. Everybody had given up on her. Her sins were bad. And Jesus sits at the well waiting for the woman. It doesn't matter how bad your sins are, Jesus will sit and he will still wait for you. Are you getting what I am saying tonight? He will sit down and wait for you. He will sit down. I don't care the number of abortions that you had. Jesus will just sit down and he will wait for you. Are you hearing what I am saying? 23 years ago, he sat down and he was waiting for me. He sat down and he was waiting for me. I was lost in my sins, lost in my transgressions. He sat down and he was waiting for me. I was lost in lies telling, lost in lust. He sat down and he was waiting for me. Tonight he is sitting down and waiting for somebody, waiting to give your life meaning, waiting to heal your body, waiting to deliver you, waiting to rescue you. Jesus Christ is seated at the well of your life, waiting to rescue you, waiting to redeem you. He's waiting tonight, he's waiting tonight, he's waiting tonight to set you free, waiting tonight to deliver you, waiting tonight to touch you, waiting tonight to bless you. Jesus is here tonight, waiting to do something in your life. He is waiting tonight, he's waiting tonight, he's waiting. He sat down waiting.
He sat down and he was waiting. You know, sometimes we want to go ahead of our lives, but God is sitting there waiting for us. Are you hearing what I'm saying? He has promised that I will never leave you, I will never forsake you. He's always there waiting for you. He said, my son, if only you could come to me, I am here waiting for you, waiting to rescue you, waiting to deliver you, waiting to free you. I am here waiting. Waiting. That's why Isaiah said the other day in Isaiah 40 and 31, he said, they that wait upon the Lord, they that wait upon the Lord, they shall renew their strength. Are you hearing what I'm saying? They that wait upon the Lord, they shall renew their strength. He sat down at the well waiting for the woman. And when the woman came, he said, give me water to drink. And the woman began saying, I am a Samaritan and you are a Jew. The Samaritans have nothing to do with the Jews. And he said, if only you knew the power of God and he that it is that is asking you for water, you would have asked me because I have what you need. I'm not telling you to give me because I have a need. I'm telling you to give me because I want to multiply it and give it back to you. Are you hearing what I'm saying? I'm telling you to give me because I want to use it to bless your life. If, don't make me miss my flight this evening. And so in John chapter 4, he's presenting Jesus Christ as that God who sits down by the well and waits for the awkward, and waits for the bad, and waits for the ugly. Are you hearing what I am saying? And waits for those people that society has rejected. He was hanging on the cross with people that were thieves, and he turned to his left hand and said, tonight you will be feasting with me in heaven. They may have accused you and killed you and hanged you on the cross. I still love you. Tonight you will be with me in paradise. I don't know who I'm talking to, but Jesus is speaking to somebody that if only you would come to him tonight, he's still able to do something in your life. He's still able to change your life, to transform your life. He's still able to bless your life. He's still able to redeem your life because he's that kind of God who loves you just the way you are. Are you hearing what I am saying? As I am speaking now, the Spirit of God is coming upon some of you. Some of you are beginning to feel the anointing of God's Spirit tonight. Are you hearing what I am saying? He is that kind of God. And so in John chapter 5, after he has been presented in John chapter 1 as the creator, after he has been presented in John chapter 2 as a miracle worker, in John chapter 3, he's been presented as the author of salvation. In John chapter 4, he's been presented as that kind of God who comes even for the rejected. In John chapter 5, he takes it to another realm. And in John chapter 5, John tells us about a man who was beside the pool of Bethesda. He had been there for 38 years. He was waiting for the troubling of the water because the Bible says once every year an angel of the Lord came down and went into the pool and troubled the water, and whoever ran into it first, that person was healed. That man was there 5 years before Jesus was born, and for 33 years he was there waiting for the troubling of the water, and Jesus comes into the scene and tells the man, take up your bed and go home. John is careful to present Jesus Christ to us as the author of healing. It doesn't matter how long your sickness has been. It doesn't matter how long your curse has been. When you encounter Jesus, in one night he will turn your life around. Are you hearing what I am saying? In one night he will turn your life around. In one night he will turn your life around. And that is what brings me now to John chapter 6, where I want to start preaching. That is what brings me to chapter 6. Because in chapter 6, John describes a feast. An amazing feast. It was a big feast in Israel. Everybody had to go up to Israel. They had to come from different places. Are you understanding what I am saying? Brother Jim, are you feeling something tonight? Are you feeling something? Are you receiving something tonight? When you go to the prisons, tell them that no matter what they have done, Jesus still loves them. When you go to the hospitals, tell them no matter how long they have been on the sick bed, God still wants to rescue them. Are you hearing what I am saying to you tonight? God still wants to touch them. In John oh my goodness, in John chapter 6, he says on the last day of the feast, just like there was a party and the party had gone on for some days, but on the last day of the feast, that greatest day, today is going to be the greatest day in somebody's life. Are you hearing what I am saying? Today's going to be the greatest day in somebody's life. God is going to do something in your life today that you have never ever experienced. God is going to touch somebody today like he has never touched you before. And your life will be completely transformed in the name of Jesus. On the last day of the feast, that great day, Jesus looked for an elevation. He stood on the platform and with a loud voice, he shouted and said, "Is there any among you who is thirsty? Is there any?" I'm going to need your watch. I need to be looking at the time. Put it in my hand. Okay, thank you. But it's not a very beautiful watch, but I can manage it. Hallelujah. Amen. I just want to make sure that I stick to the time. Hallelujah. He said on the last day of the feast, he went up an elevation and with a loud voice, he declared, "Is there any among you who is thirsty? Is there any among you who is thirsty?" Because all along it had been about what Jesus can do. But by the time we get to chapter 6, Jesus is trying to shift the focus. He says all along, the first few chapters has been about what I can do, about who I am. But in chapter 6, he says, "I want it to be about you. I want it to be about you." So in John chapter 6, he stood up and shouted with a loud voice, "Is there any among you that is thirsty? Let him come to me and drink. And whosoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of their belly shall flow rivers of living water." He said, "Whosoever believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of their belly shall flow rivers of living water." And the Bible says that what he was making reference to, he was making reference to the Holy Spirit of God. Because as of this time, the Holy Spirit had not yet been given because Jesus had not been to the cross. And when the people heard it, they said, "Wow, this man is true."